Good morning and a warm welcome to the meeting of the Constitution, the 14th meeting of the Constitution Europe Exile Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Today, Mr. Bibby is joining us online, and we are also joined in the committee substitute, Kevin Stewart, MSP, so welcome. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take item 3 in private? Okay. Thank you very much. Our next agenda item is to take evidence from Kate of Scotland on its funding of RAIN. Can I welcome to the meeting Ian Munro, Chief Executive of Creative Scotland, and Robert Wilson, Chair of the Board. I'd like to invite Mr. Wilson to make a brief opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. We welcome this opportunity to give evidence to the committee this morning regarding our recent funding award to the RAIN project and our subsequent withdrawal of that funding. A lot has been written and said about the matter in the media, online, and elsewhere. Some of this has been accurate and measured, and some of it has not. However, an alarming amount of it has been offensive, dangerous, constituting attacks on the artists involved, marginalised parts of our society, and unfortunately our staff. I hope the committee will agree that this is not acceptable and join us in condemning that type of discourse and behaviour. Having made that point, I'd like to start with a bit of context. Creative Scotland, including Screen Scotland, receives more than 4,000 applications each year, and we make in the region of 2,000 individual funding awards, drawing on a budget totalling £90 million with the support of Scottish Government and the UK National Lottery. With this funding, we support an inspirational range and breadth of fantastic artists, filmmakers, writers, performers, festivals, and cultural organisations who together make Scotland's vibrant and diverse culture the vital component of all our lives, and that it undoubtedly is, and contributes so powerfully to our global reputation. Of course, as the committee has heard previously many times, we would be able to support significantly many more artists, creative projects, and organisations if more funds were available to us. That challenge will continue for as long as we remain on inadequate funding levels, irrespective of this significant controversy over this one award. As we speak, we only have the funding available to support around 30% of the applications to our open fund and the multi-year funding programme, which, as you're aware, is currently live, and has at least twice as many applications as we have funds to support. Given this context, funding for culture is always going to be challenging, and at times controversial, because tough choices have to be made. Nevertheless, it is vital that Creative Scotland continues to provide our support to creative work that represents all of Scotland across all art forms and areas of practice, representing and reaching all of our diverse communities. As well as being in keeping with our desire to support as broad a range of artistic and creative practice as possible, we also have a legal responsibility to promote equality, diversity, and inclusion. It is also not our role to act as censor or the arbiter of cultural taste, but to support cultural and artistic diversity as an expression of human rights, something as important in Scotland as it is anywhere else, and expressed so clearly by the United Nations and UNESCO to promote and protect artistic freedom for its contribution to the progressive cultures worldwide. It is within this overall context that we supported the RAIN project, firstly through an initial research and development phase, and then following an application and assessment to progress the project through our open fund for individuals. The project was supported in the knowledge that it would be challenging, creatively ambitious piece of work, with strong sexual themes at its heart, speaking to a particular audience more than the mainstream. The project was also being produced by an artist and a supporting team with a strong nationally recognized track record, and the support of respected sector partners, and with the potential international interest. While a project report at the end of the R&D phase did mention non-simulated sex as part of the potential forward thinking, it is important to restate that any such reference did not feature in the subsequent separate application that we received. It is not unusual for projects to change between the R&D phase and any follow-up application. It is this subsequent substantive application which was assessed and recommended for funding, a recommendation which was ultimately awarded by the funding panel, consisting of Creative Scotland employees and independent assessors. All the specialist roles, safeguards and protections in the application we received were expected industry standards for work of this kind involving simulated sexual content. They were not an indication of real sex being involved. However, after this award was made, it became evident through the call out for participants instigated by the awardee that the intention to include non-simulated sex for some parts of the work was being pursued. Once this became clear to the senior management of Creative Scotland, legal advice was taken, breach of contract was confirmed, and the funding was reclaimed. This action was not contested by the applicant, and the bulk of the funds have now been returned. We have not misled anyone on these facts. Before we open discussions, I'd like to make a few final points. We remain committed to the artistic freedom and to supporting a broad range of artists and as much work as possible. At times, this will include work that pushes the boundaries, that polarizes opinion, and that will inevitably, albeit occasionally, create controversy. People may sometimes disagree with or dislike some of the work we support. This is the nature of funding the arts, and indeed of the arts themselves. However, there is always learning in situations like this, and the senior leadership team at Creative Scotland, with the support of the board, have reviewed the application process for open funding and have introduced new safeguards, including an additional stage of review for all applications that are recommended for funding. The board has also agreed to a more cautious approach to risk in terms of our future funding of projects with sexual conduct, content, and those that involve vulnerable people or children. Finally, the Board of Creative Scotland, including myself as chair, remain unanimously supportive of Ian as our chief executive, of the senior team, and indeed of all our staff. Everyone at Creative Scotland continues to be dedicated to their diligent work in support of culture and creativity in Scotland. This has never been more apparent than over the past few years, where Creative Scotland's team has delivered huge volumes of vital support to the culture sector during the COVID pandemic and indeed the challenging period since. Their work continues to deliver so much benefit to Scotland and our communities. Ian, myself, and our colleagues on the board and all our staff remain committed to playing our part in helping culture and creative in Scotland to thrive. I'll stop at this point, convener, and Ian and I are happy to take questions and look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. And I'm sure I speak for all the committee when I say that abuse and threats are of any kind to staff or to artists is completely unacceptable. From my own point of view, this is not about, as we say, the content and the nature of the production of Rain, but whether the process was robust and diligent and fair. So if I could ask Mr. Munro, you were very explicit to say that the artist didn't contest the reasons for the withdrawal of the grant. But Mr. Munro, in your Chief Executive's report to Creative Scotland on the 21st of March, she stated that the artist had, quote, expressed a fundamental disagreement with your analysis and decision when you met with her in person. So that seems an inconsistency in those two positions.
Yeah, thank you, and morning, everyone. So the conversation with the artist, of course, moved very quickly into a legal process. And my point about not contesting is part of that legal process. What the artist is clear about is that they do not agree with our decision, and have said so publicly, but did not at any point seek to contest the legal process that we moved into.
Could I move to questions from the committee, and I'm going to move first to Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. This entire saga has cast a dark shadow over Creative Scotland. I think in your opening statement, Mr. Wilson, you suggested it had significant controversy. I would suggest that was the least of the situation. I think significant controversy is where we are with this whole application. And the application itself and the public statements that have been made since differ. I mean, we've seen lots of information through, we've been privy to see over the last few days. And that the explicit nature of the project in itself made it significantly controversial. So can I ask, has an assessment been made of the reputational damage that this has created for Creative Scotland and the sector, and what that damage is?
So I'll take that. Of course, this is ongoing. It's always going to now be a reference point in the history of Creative Scotland. I would ask for the context to be borne in mind. As Robert said, this is one significant, nonetheless, controversial award amongst the vast majority of awards that we make that are straightforward and uncontroversial and deliver great value. I think for us as Creative Scotland, we're in no doubt the extent to which this is reputationally damaging, but I'm as concerned about the extent to which this is damaging for the sector as a whole, and the risk that it places to undermine the case for investment that we've been so diligently speaking about, I personally in front of the committee on several occasions and publicly, about the need for support for the cultural sector for it to continue to thrive. I want to be quite clear, though, that one controversial award does not make a systemic problem with our processes. And I would want to reassure the committee and others more widely about the robustness of our processes. But as Robert has said, there is always learning to be had in any of these examples where this has become a matter of public debate and interest, and understandably so. What I would refer you to in the bigger context as well is that we are one of a number of similar bodies, not just across the UK, but around the world, that experience similar challenges in terms of funding support for this kind of work and it being picked up in a public way and presented back as unacceptable. And I think there are two things that we need to be mindful of in this public discourse. So one is about the fact that sex and sexuality have always been a feature of art in its multiple art forms throughout the ages, and will continue to be so. But that's separate and different from the assurances that I think, Convener, that you're referring to, which is about the robustness of our processes. And I'm happy to set out in more detail what we have done by way of immediate learning and changes to our processes to strengthen safeguards and checks and balances should instances like this arise in the future. And to also look towards more permanent changes that we will make and put in place in the longer term.
And your letter to us, Mr. Munro, or to the convener on the 16th of April, to the committee, you expressed that RAIN was originally supported in the knowledge that it would be challenging, creatively ambitious, a piece of performance art, and was a clear storytelling narrative, strong sexual themes and simulated sexual performance. But it was very much the case that this was not simulated. And looking at some of the information we've seen from Freedom of Information, right from the start, genital contact and sexual performance was being indicated. Why did you say that to us on the 16th of April, knowingly that the information was not correct?
I don't agree with that, and I said it because it's the truth. The fact of genital contact in the nature of this work, and I'm sure it's a revelation and to see inside our processes and the extent of the material that we get and the nature of the material. But as Robert alluded to in his opening statement, the content that was included in that application was consistent, involving all of the requisite specialist expertise, roles, safeguards, protections. All of that was consistent with our understanding of it as a simulated, performed piece of work. There was no mention, this is fact, there was no mention of real or non-simulated sex in the application. There is no connection between the end of project monitoring report, which came out of the first R&D award, and what was in the substantive application. We only make decisions on what is in the application. And whilst that was challenging in its content and had strong sexual themes, all of it was consistent with what we would expect to see by way of industry standards for simulated sexual activity. And if the committee is interested in understanding this more, I can follow up with an example of how this is very carefully managed. There's a Beck too, who are involved in supporting this kind of work, have produced a guidance, supporting guidance on shooting of intimacy. And what you will see within that includes genital contact. The mere mention of it does not mean real sex. Genital contact can be simulated, and I would suggest that you only need to switch on the television or go into streaming platforms to see sexual activity of a simulated nature on our screens frequently. It's not real, it's simulated, and there are ways of tackling it. So I am very clear that my presentation to you of the facts remain, and that the mention of genital contact does not mean real sex. That was not and never has been our understanding.
And finally, what lessons can be learned from this entire saga and to try and rebuild the confidence in the sector and deal with that reputational damage that you've already alluded to?
So part of this has to be about the robustness of our processes and the evidence of that. And that I will, as I've committed to, share more about the permanent changes that we will be building into our processes as part of additional checks and safeguards, given the more cautious risk appetite that Robert's mentioned. So it has to be about that and how that works in practice. We're paying very diligent attention to what we are funding and what we're not funding, more than ever, at the most senior levels of the organisation. We have an expertise in our staff that we should trust and do trust. I think people need to see the evidence as it continues to flow through from the decisions that we make. But I think some of this has to be about the context and assurances around Creative Scotland. Our reputation, like you say, has to be about not just the evidence of those processes, but actually our engagement with the wider sector to provide reassurance, because one of the downsides of what has happened is that people have misunderstood the fact that the project moved from simulated sex to real sex and we withdrew the award. That is not an indication that we are stepping away from our commitments to equalities, diversity and inclusion. Far from it, we remain committed to our work in that area and speaking to all of Scotland's communities and audiences. Final thing I would say is that whilst the language in the application will be a surprise to some people, this is a language that is recognised by the queer community, does not provoke them in the way that provokes a reaction in the wider public. And so all of that is taken into account when we assess these applications. But it's really important that we have time and space for people to come forward with ideas that they want to pursue as artists, but it doesn't necessarily mean that we will, that it merits public funding. How that works is down to the how well projects meet the criteria and the intended outcomes that we're seeking to achieve.
Thank you, Convener.
Could I just clarify one point in that? And you said that it was all industry standards, the stuff that was in the original application. But in the risk section of the application, it does state where necessary, COVID and STI tests will be done by performers ahead of rehearsals, with risk assessments done with the results. Are STI tests industry standard for production?
So some aspects, and this would be one of them, go beyond industry standards into best practice. I'm certainly no microbiologist or medical expert, but where projects of this nature involved with nakedness and contact and touching, STIs don't simply exist only in genital areas. So for us, this would be an additional strengthening of the safeguards within the project that would be appropriate to see.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Mr. Bibby next. Online.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener. And good morning to the panel. We just heard there that Creative Scotland's letter to the committee and wider statements to the media have suggested it believed no non-simulated sexual activity was to take place as part of the project. However, we just heard from Alexander Stewart about genital contact being in the application. And as you, Convener, have said, we've just heard about STI checks being part of the application. We have mentioned in the application of a sex party, two sexual acts beginning with F, people working on it with experience in pornography. And I think, as you've just said earlier, it was suggested that in the R&D phase that there would be non-simulated sex. So surely, is that all correct? That was all in the application, all the things that we've just mentioned?
All those references were in the application except non-simulated sex.
Surely, given the everything that was in the application, the suggestion in the R&D phase of non-simulated sex, that surely should have raised eyebrows at that point and provoked at least some further explanation from the assessor on the nature of the sexual activity involved.
So, as I mentioned earlier, the conclusion of the first R&D phase, as common with all of those kinds of awards, gives us a report on what the outcome was. There were two references to non-simulated sex in that end-of-project monitoring form, neither of which made it into the actual application that we received. And as I've said, we only make decisions on the content of the actual application that we received. Now, this is a learning point in terms of understanding, given the nature of this kind of application, that we need to look to how we can strengthen the checks within an application to understand it a bit more. But as given the nature of organisation that we are and the vast majority of the work that we are engaged with and fund, the starting point has always been, as presented right from the off in the original R&D application too, that this was an art installation that involved some strong sexual content, but there was more to it than just a film. and it's certainly not a hardcore porn film nor a hardcore sex film. It was an art installation that involved dance, theatre, video, sound, lighting, stage design, and set build for the experience of audiences. So there's much more to this than just the sexual element of it. So our starting point has always been and continue to be the evidence in the application. And the evidence in the application, whilst challenging, was not understood nor presented as involving anything other than simulated sex.
I think what was in the application should have been sending off alarm bells, personally, but Mr. Wilson said earlier that we've not misled anyone. I wonder if, from what you're saying in terms of the application, what it was to turn out to be in terms of real-life sex, do you believe Creative Scotland were misled by the applicant in relation to the nature of the project?
I can see no evidence, excuse me, I can see no evidence that the applicant, the artist, misled us. As Robert has said, it's not our job to act as censor or arbiters of taste. It doesn't mean to say that everything we receive by way of application should be awarded public funding. But we have robust processes in place to be able to tackle the challenging content that you've seen in that application. And I wouldn't disagree that we are looking to do more to understand how we can have escalation points within any future projects that might come forward of this nature. But this is a very rare example of this kind of project that we would ever receive an application on. So I think there are learnings, I would concede that. We don't censor work. If a project like this were to come forward again with a broad set of objectives from an artistic point of view, but have explicit sexual content at its core, would it be eligible? Probably. Would it be fundable? Possibly, if it met the criteria. Would it be funded? Not necessarily, because we don't make decisions on applications in isolation. Individual applications are individually assessed, but they go forward to a panel alongside a basket of other applications that are in competition for funds at the same time. And that panel makes a decision in the round of all of those applications, with those that are strongest in terms of addressing the criteria and the outcomes that we're seeking from the fund. So that's the way the process operates. And to answer your question again, I don't believe we were misled. I can see no evidence of it. But clearly, there's a point of understanding at which we diverged after the award was made, when at that point, the call-out revealed that non-simulated sex was a part of the intended outcomes of the project. And that was when we intervened very quickly, withdrew the funding, and have had subsequently that funding repaid in bulk.
We've we've discussed already the public discourse and the reaction to the funding grant. The committee wrote to Creative Scotland on the 25th of March for asking for the application to be published. We felt that was in the interests of public confidence and transparency. And Creative Scotland responded on the 16th of April, stating whilst it was an intention to publish the application, this could not be done until a thorough review of the materials was undertaken to remove any personal information, any business confidential information, or any information that, if publicly disclosed, could pose a threat to an individual. You'll note that the application under materials were released under FOI on Tuesday the 21st of May, and the first I heard of it as the application process was through the media. But the committee wasn't sent the full application until the 22nd of May. Can you clarify why, when the committee asked for the application to be published on the 25th of March, why the committee had to learn about it through the media a day later?
So there are a number of factors in play here. As I've already talked about and shared with the committee in my previous correspondence, within a matter of days of this becoming a media story, a matter of public concern, we had met with the applicant and moved immediately, identifying a breach of contract, into a legal process. With legal input and support and advice, we had to manage that in a very careful way so as to avoid doing anything to disrupt the withdrawal of the grant and the repayment of the funding. So that was a factor in how we had to operate, but also what we were able to say, which was factual and minimal in the public domain whilst that process was ongoing. Now, that process concluded in April, which was then the point at which I was able to set out more by way of a response to the committee in my letter of the 16th of April. Whilst all of that was ongoing, we've had 23 FOIs related to this matter. It's the largest FOI interest we've ever had. And when we've gone through those FOIs and compiling the material, we've had 12,000 different files associated with those FOI requests, which we've had to go through with very careful legal support to ensure that we're releasing the maximum amount of information and complying with the FOI legislation, whilst also being mindful of that toxic environment in which this was going to be released. And it was only when we got to that point in May that we were in a position to release the FOIs. And I did write to the committee. I appreciate there was a sequencing point that you're making there, but it was not the intention to do anything other than what I had committed to, which was to release the material appropriately under the FOIs and to share that information with the committee as requested and as I have subsequently done.
Well, I think the FOIs were published on the 21st and the committee got the application on the 22nd. I think that's very regrettable that we were not given it when we asked for it, or at least when the FOI was published. On the issue of transparency, you'll be aware, and going back to the previous points about alarm bells should have been ringing, you'll be aware that internal emails, as reported, I think, in the Times newspaper, from September 2022, just a month after the project was awarded funding, suggested that the project could cause concern if picked up by the press. Were either of you personally aware of these concerns? And if so, did you speak with the individual who had raised them, and did you feel assured that those concerns were misplaced?
Neither of us were aware of those concerns, but they were certainly within the organisation. But no, direct answer to your question, not aware of that at the time.
And Mr. Wilson?
Likewise.
Okay, thank you for your answers. And one last question, Convener. Substantial funds have been were awarded to the project R&D phase and in the application, over £100,000. Could you just clarify the amount of money that was awarded? And we've heard this morning that the bulk of the funds have been repaid. Can you just clarify how much was awarded and how much has been repaid?
So I've set this out in my letter to the committee, but to recap, the original R&D awarded in August 2022 was £23,219. The subsequent application, which was initially successful but then withdrawn, totaled £84,555. All of that has been reclaimed with the exception of £8,359, which was legitimate expenditure accrued from the point of award contract to the point at which the award was withdrawn. So that's in relation to the £83,555. The 1,219 for the original award. There was no reason to revisit that. It had delivered the outcomes and objectives that the award had been approved for.
So £31,578 has not been recovered or repaid?
Has not been reclaimed by us, no.
Yeah, 31,000. Thank you. That's all, convened.
The final figure is 76,100 of the actual delivery award has been returned to us. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Gallagher. Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, gentlemen. I don't think anyone doubts the work of Creative Scotland and the artists that it supports, and we do fully understand and I sincerely sympathise with the budget constraints that you're working within as well. I understand how tough that must be, particularly when you've got so many applications coming through and the number of artists that you do want to support. However, we do have this application issue in front of us, and questions, serious questions, do need to be asked about the handling of this and how best to move forward with Creative Scotland. It's already been mentioned this morning regarding the funding application that stated in the second phase of research and development that the applicant would be working on a sex scene with genital contact. We've also heard this morning that the budget and risk assessment would include STI tests, but also lubricant. So you've spoken about the STI test in terms of safeguarding, but surely lubricant would assume that this would be much further than simulated sex. That would move into non-simulated sex. And why weren't questions asked about that part?
I can appreciate you reading it in that way. It wasn't our reading of it in the assessment, because the starting point had been as performed simulated sex being our understanding. But I do appreciate as a specific point that it should escalate for more attention within a process where this kind of application to come forward again, and that's what we are committed to doing, where that to happen.
Been a serious overlooked element then, because I don't understand how that particular item could be placed on a budget and risk assessment if it wasn't going to be used for a particular purpose.
So again, it's our expectation, given that it was simulated, performed piece of work, that all these protections would be in place. The mere mention, a bit like genital contact or STI, that lubrication is involved does not necessarily mean real sex. I can appreciate the reading of it. I've acknowledged that actually mentions like that can be better picked up through the assessment process. I don't think there has been a failing in the process in the way that you can read it now, given the context that we were in at the time. But I absolutely concede that it should be one of those flags for us that mean that we need to understand it in a bit more detail to ensure and assure everyone within the process and more widely, were it to be successful, that real sex is not involved.
It was mentioned in phase two of the research and the development. Okay. So you've mentioned as well the genital contact aspect, and of course through the many articles that's been written about the application in recent times, there has been several interviews conducted, some with intimacy coordinators. One intimacy coordinator says that all genital contact falls within the definition of non-simulated sex. That was obviously within the phase two of the research and development aspect of the application with a sex with genital contact. So do you agree with that statement from the intimacy coordinator that was interviewed? And if you don't, what evidence do you have that states the contrary to that?
So I don't agree with it. I know the reference that you're making. It was an anonymous source. I don't doubt the source, but I mentioned earlier on, and I'm happy to follow up with the committee on this, an example of industry guidance that supports the shooting of intimacy in simulated sex. And within that, what you will see are references to genital contact and how safeguards are in place in simulated sex to manage genital contact. But the mere mention of genital contact alone does not mean real sex. You will see that in the guidance that I will send to the committee. With the coordination of intimacy coordinators, other specialist expertise, and protections and indeed physical barriers, genital contact is part of simulated sex, as you will see in the guidance, and is as we understood it when we were assessing it.
I think that does bring me on to the guidance and the strategic framework for which applications are measured against before they are approved. Who signs off the strategic framework for applications to be approved? Who creates the guidance? Who creates the strategic framework?
So our overall sort of corporate strategic framework is developed by me with the staff body, approved by the board and by Scottish ministers. So that sets our key priorities and outcomes and KPIs. All of that is as published. And what that does then is to frame and translate into the criteria that we use in the funding programmes that we run. We have four key areas of priority. One is EDI, one is fair work, one is sustainable development, and one is international. And what you will find is in various forums, increasingly as we revise funding, given that we signed off the framework relatively recently, a couple of years ago, that all of those are translating now into the funds that we operate in some way, shape or form. The guidance is reviewed annually, and the framework that we operate to is very publicly published through that guidance and updated as we need to. And some of the updates on the Open Fund for Individuals, which was the source for this award, have already incorporated some of the additional strengthening and due diligence that we've put into the process as a result of this controversial award. And we'll do further, on the deeper review that we're doing, we'll do further revisions and changes that will be built into the guidance going forward. So the approvals of all of that are undertaken through the senior leadership team and we're relevant with the board, but it's consistent back to the corporate framework that I mentioned earlier.
Okay, thank you. And in terms of concerns, has any concerns ever been raised about that framework, about the guidance up until this point, you know, throughout the history of the applications being processed and approved?
No.
No.
No concerns about the guidance, but I'd be interested if you are trying to identify concerns in what regard. No, I mean, not everybody agrees with the priorities that we've got or the criteria that we use and the decisions that we make, clearly, but it's all very clearly set out with a strategic rationale in mind and underpinning it. But no concerns raised in the way that you've asked.
Yeah. And given, obviously, what's happened, is there now intentions between Creative Scotland, Scottish Government, to re-look at this? I know you're saying you're strengthening the guidance and the framework, but is there an overall strategy that will need to be re-looked at in order to restore public confidence in what's happened?
The operational detail of how these funds work is entirely arm's length from government. That rests with the board and myself and the staff of Creative Scotland. We operate to that strategic framework, set of priorities that I've talked about, but we translate that then into how we operate our processes. As I mentioned earlier, this is one very high profile and significant controversial award. It has enabled us to identify that we can learn and do more to strengthen our processes around this kind of work were it to come forward again. But it doesn't indicate a systemic failure at the heart of our processes, which continue to operate and largely uncontentious, setting aside the controversy over never having enough funding to award the awards that we would like to make.
One final question, if I may, Convener, thank you. The problem that we've got, and I understand what you have said this morning, but the problem that we've got is we've got two different assessments here as to what's happened. We've got the assessment from Creative Scotland and we've got the assessment from the project itself, and they have got contradictions throughout, whether that be in terms of the application process itself or indeed whether or not the application, you know, the decision and outcome of removing the funding from the application was disputed. So I do need to ask a direct question. Both of those assessments can't be correct. Which assessment is correct?
My assessment is correct, and I say that because I take my role as Chief Executive and Accountable Officer extremely seriously. Anyone who knows me knows that I operate in the utmost professional and way with integrity, bearing in mind the Nolan principles. I don't operate in a way that seeks to do anything other than operate in an open and transparent way. I want you to be assured by my evidence. The artists can only speak for themselves. They disagree with our assessment, as I've said, but the fact is it was not contested in the event where a breach was identified and we moved through a legal process to withdraw the funding, which has subsequently been repaid.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks. Mr. Munro, you spoke earlier about the kind of toxic environment that's been created around discussion of this individual project. And Mr. Wilson, you mentioned in your opening comments about the impact on the creatives and the artists and the participants and others, the negative impact on social media and in the wider media. Can you explain what that impact has been?
So some of it's personal, and we've spoken very clearly about the extent we have concerns about this going beyond reasonable check and challenge in a public discourse into a kind of polarised debate, a very toxic debate in this instance involving culture wars. We're always going to try and remain above that and not feed it, but we are mindful of what that means for the artists involved and the artist team involved, whom I believe have operated with integrity in their own way. We just have a disagreement about the line that was crossed. Ultimately, public funding being used to pay people to have real sex is the line that was crossed, and that's not acceptable, whatever the challenges of the original assessment. I think it's worth saying, as well as the kind of broader context about this being one controversial award, it occasionally happens, not just for us, but across the UK and around the world. There are others who are not visibly speaking publicly who have confidence in Creative Scotland, see and understand and value the work that we do, trust it. But I absolutely understand that we need to work hard to make sure that everybody, as far as they reasonably can, whilst they may not agree with decisions that we make, at least have trust and confidence in the processes that we run and operate. And some of that is what has been damaged. So what I'm setting out today, and we will continue to do, is to acknowledge there is learning in this, to be confident about the processes that we run, addressing the majority of the work that we do, but where there are instances like this that are likely to risk controversy or push boundaries in such a radical, explicit way, that we have additional checks and balances that can deal with that. It's really important that artists know and understand that they can come to us with boundary-pushing, challenging ideas. It's a core tenet of artistic freedom, as Robert said, that's set out for very clearly from the UN and UNESCO. And it's an important part, whether people agree with the decisions or not, it's an important part of a progressive democratic society. So we are trying to get the balance right in all of this, to create the conditions for that, but managed in an appropriate way that accounts in a transparent way for the public funding that we are a channel for. And as I mentioned earlier, artists are free to bring forward ideas that they want to pursue. It does not necessarily mean that they will always be supported by public funding to pursue them.
And you mentioned earlier as well about how themes around sex and sexuality have always been part of art and culture. Do you see that there's potentially a chilling effect now, given the controversy surrounding this individual project, that artists and creators may be more reluctant to bring forward challenging projects, controversial projects, as a result of the kind of furore and the kind of public discourse that we've seen on this?
For some, that may be the case, but for others, there will be a determination to ensure that that artistic freedom continues. So we will see both. I think the danger is that this is a significant matter of public concern. I understand and would not disagree with that. But it is overshadowing all the other excellent work that is being supported and that the artistic and creative community across Scotland continues to deliver. And I think the chilling effect isn't just what comes through, but I know from my international networks that this has caught the attention around the world in a way that is not helpful to Scotland, actually, given the strength of our culture and the cultural renown globally, and a disbelief that one such significant controversial award could risk undermining our strong cultural reputation abroad, as well as the domestic culture that we've got. So I think, as I say, we're trying to get the balance right on all of this to make sure that we can move forward confidently. But there are some people in certain quarters who feel they don't want to speak up because they will be caught up in the culture wars debate that has become the kind of toxic element that sits as a result of this one award becoming so public.
And obviously that is difficult for you to manage, that public discourse, and, you know, if it turns into a culture war, it's very difficult for you to kind of get through that. But do you see that there were perhaps key points when the Times letter came out, when there was a need for clarity? Were there key points where Creative Scotland could have or should have provided more information, or in your view, do you think you did that, but it perhaps wasn't being heard because of, you know, an overwhelming culture war on social media around this topic?
I'm not clear about the exact Times letter that you're referring to, but nonetheless, the principle of what you're talking about, as I said earlier, we were very quickly into a breach of contract and a legal process to withdraw the award and recover the funds. We had to operate with legal advice in a very particular way to manage, and it had a bearing on what we were able to say publicly whilst we went through that legal process. It did conclude, however, and then we moved into the detail of the FOI's release, which, as I said, had 12,000 files that we had to review and prepare for release, and that just took time. We've got one trained specialist in the organisation who deals with FOIs. This is the largest ever that we've had to deal with by way of volume, so it just necessarily took a bit longer than we would have hoped. But I recognise that people may have wanted more information sooner, but the reality is that we weren't in a position to be able to say anything, particularly because we were going through that legal process, and our legal advice was very clear around our ability to say very much at that point.
Okay, thanks. Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Stewart, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. You have said this morning that the decisions that you take are arm's length from government, arm's length from politicians. That's probably a very wise thing, considering what we have seen in certain places in the past in terms of politicians trying to be the censors, including in the United States at various points, particularly the likes of Jesse Helms. But you're going to be under a huge amount more scrutiny now after what is seen by many as a controversial application garnering public money. And Mr. Munro, you said that one controversial award does not mean a systemic problem. But you may have a little bit of risk aversity now in terms of applications. How are you going to get over that? And maybe you can give us an indication of when last an application garnered as much controversy as this one?
I can't recall an instance.
Okay.
Certainly in recent history of this. I've observed it elsewhere, beyond Scotland, but not an instance like this for us in the way that we've been experiencing. The business of risk is very interesting that you've raised. So as we've noted, we're trying to get the balance right between artistic freedoms that enable people to come forward with often boundary-pushing ideas and find a channel that enables us to engage with that and decide whether it's something that we are prepared to fund or not. We have, in broad terms, an open risk appetite to creative and artistic risk. But what this has revealed is that, as Robert noted in opening statement, that where there are applications that have strong, explicit sexual content of the nature that we've just been talking about with this one, or involves vulnerable groups or children, they will have a more cautious risk appetite. But it still means that we are prepared to fund what might be challenging, boundary-pushing pieces of work that might risk controversy. What we will be doing is providing additional scrutiny on the process of assessment and approvals, and if it is approved, as we have put in additional assurances already, we will look to strengthen through conditions or reporting or monitoring the safeguards that will enable us to still support controversial work potentially, but in a more managed way. So I think there is a risk it could spill over into being risk averse, but it's fundamentally important that we continue to have an appetite on these kinds of works, a bit more cautious, but nonetheless an appetite for work that is going to challenge us and push the boundaries. It's a vital part of the health of a dynamic culture that we support many aspects of.
Thank you. So this is the first time that there's been this level of controversy because of a Creative Scotland Award, yes?
I can think of it in relation to this kind of example, yes.
Okay. Can I ask Mr. Wilson, in terms of the board here, in terms of ensuring, you know, that artistic freedom continues to flourish, but also recognising, you know, that public money is involved and there are people out there with differing views about what money should be spent on. What does the board do in terms of looking at the overall actions of the day-to-day work of the Creative Scotland employees?
Well, firstly, I appreciate a number of you understanding this risk balance and the need to ensure that creativity is given as much an opportunity to flourish as possible. However, you know, as soon as the rain situation became clear to us, which was in March, we had a board meeting in March, and the decision was taken that the board needed to raise its risk appetite. And as I said in my opening statement, it was very clear that anything that had sexual content needed to raise a red flag at board level. Not just that, but also vulnerable people and children. So if any proposal comes forward to any level of the organisation that includes any of those three categories, a red flag must be raised and it must come straight up to board level. So that has been implemented from March forward. As I also mentioned, Ian has referenced the other process. Every award now has a senior leadership member of the team assessing it at the final stages. So there have been these double gateways that have been increased in scrutiny following this situation.
Thank you. Mr. Munro, you mentioned fair work in terms of one of the principles that Creative Scotland follows. And I know I'm going off on a little bit of a tangent here, convener, but trawling through the vast bulk of information that the committee have received, including all of the FOIs, there's an email around about the ad, and it says that it's been looked at by a member of the team in terms of meeting minimum wage and being funded by CS. Now, minimum wage is not fair work in my book. Are we making sure that all of the applications that you receive and fund are actually meeting real living wage fair work principles rather than minimum wage as it indicates in that email?
That might be a language issue. I'm not familiar with the absolute detail of that, but we have an absolute commitment to fair work and the principles. We've got this all laid out comprehensively on our website and translating into our applications. So I suspect that's a language issue rather than any concern around the detail of real living wage that you're making.
Clarified to the committee around about applications who are funded meeting fair work principles?
Yeah, and we're reporting on this up through into Scottish Government structures, so we can follow this up with you, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Brown?
Could I just say at the start, today Dean Ronaldson retires after more than two decades of working here as a security guard, and I think it's probably important that we put on the official report our thanks to him for his service over the last couple of decades. Yeah, it's at least 20 years, and I think we rely very much on security staff in the Parliament, so I just wanted to mention that at the start. On the issues, I mean, we've heard talk of toxic environment and of culture wars. You've even heard quite a chilling assertion that the Scottish Government should be involved in setting up the guidance, which I'm sure would be a chill run down the spine of much of the artistic community to hear that being said. On the point about the toxic environment and what's led to it, there's a lot of misinformation. A member of this committee has referred to you as an SNP quangle. Now, I know this sounds a bit absurd, but if you could just confirm that the SNP has no control, has no contact with, has no reporting lines with Creative Scotland, that'd be useful for the public record.
That is correct. We are an apolitical organisation in NDPB, arm's length from government. We are not an SNP body. We do, however, report to the Scottish Government and Scottish ministers, but we are your point is correct.
Yeah, and you've said that this the stoking of this controversy has led to, I forget exactly what you said, but the international awareness of it, which you said was not helpful to Scotland and its reputation throughout the world. I would just suggest that those responsible for the culture wars couldn't care less if that's the case. There's a point to what they do here, trying to undermine institutions such as your own. But can I just ask about national lottery funding? Because I know that you get partial national lottery funding. And just as the Scottish Government were not involved in this, I take it the National Lottery weren't involved or haven't expressed concerns to or in any way involved in this, is that right?
That's correct.
And I notice also in the details that you sent us that was to be a performance, I think, in Camden as well, as part of this proposal, Camden, London. I just wondered, in the correspondence that you've received and concerns that have been expressed, has any of that come from out with Scotland, for example, in London or elsewhere?
Yes, I mean, this goes, particularly in the online environment, you know, the public discourse goes beyond the domestic borders, as it were. So, yeah, there's commentary and critique on this that is beyond Scotland, yeah.
I think that's all the questions I'd give you.
Okay. Are there any further questions? Yep, Mark.
Just following up from that, I'm just wondering if you think that there are lessons for politicians and the media in terms of how issues like this are discussed, the facts behind these kind of controversies and the kind of impact that it has, particularly on artists, marginalised communities, in that very febrile, judgmental kind of environment?
I think that's a helpful question, because I do think that facts always need to be at the, and evidence always need to be at the heart of public discourse. And what we've found is that, and I'm sure this is something that's now more evident, that these kinds of controversial awards occasionally happen. We've talked about trying to find the balance of artistic freedom versus processes that enable appropriate support using public funds. But when they blow up in a very urgent way, we keep a cool, calm head with appropriate legal and other specialist expertise to manage that on behalf of the business of Creative Scotland. But what we and we can only put out so much in terms of our own messaging. It doesn't necessarily mean to say that that has any impact on reporting or the public discourse to the extent that we would want it to. So the only thing we can control is our own voice. But there is an extent to which many have jumped on the controversy surrounding this war, this award, both in terms of the nature of the content, as well as the processes and the sort of probity of Creative Scotland. And I would counsel any politician or political party thinking that it can or should seek to control the work of artists and censor the work of artists and the arts community. It's a vital component part, as recognised by the UN and UNESCO, of progressive, dynamic, democratic cultures. So I think always coming back to facts and evidence, I'm trying to give assurance to the committee and use this as a vehicle to speak to the wider interested parties on this. I'm not saying anybody else anywhere, including the recipient artists in this, has misled anyone. I don't believe that to be the case, as I've been asked. But it's really important always that the facts need to come out. Unfortunately, they often get overwhelmed by speculation, supposition and inference. So these are important opportunities for us to set the public record straight, but also for all of us to learn what it actually means when these controversial awards happen. And they will occasionally happen. Not willingly, but you can never tell what people are going to land on necessarily. So I think it's an important question that you raise, but the public discourse needs to be more intelligently informed, I think, by facts and evidence. And we need to work hard to make sure that we, in the organisation that we are and the work that we do, can feed that as urgently and as quickly and as appropriately as we can. Transparency and accountability is a big part of what we do.
Thank you. I'm looking. I can ask a final question, Mr. Munro. Sorry, Mr. Wilson, but Mr. Munro, you mentioned earlier Leone Gasson's credentials as an artist. I've been of the high standard that they were, and you've used the term contested. The legal action wasn't contested. But can I just be clear that your understanding is there's a fundamental disagreement between the artists and yourselves about how the initial application was interpreted, and while it's not legally contested, that the artist remains concerned at the interpretation and has a fundamental disagreement with you on that interpretation? Thank you. And asked at the start about whether the processes have been robust and fair and diligent, and you've explained how that you've changed those processes as well. Do you think that this has been fair on the artist, and do you appreciate that there's always also been reputational damage potentially as a result of the controversy around this application and the way it's been handled?
I think it has, as a kind of public discourse, been very concerning for the artists. It's why we've always sought to operate with sensitivity and care around the artist and the artist team who have been the subject of unfair, vitriolic attacks online, but even doorstepping. That's not acceptable, and we're all agreed on that, like you said. We have not wanted to act in any way that was undermining of the artist, but there's no question that in withdrawing the award, that clearly has a bearing on the artist, and we're disappointed that this is the situation that we find ourselves in. But as a public body handling public funding, we need to be mindful of how that is accounted for. And in this context, there was a breach of contract, and we've acted accordingly. But as I say, we've sought all the way through this behind the scenes to continue our contact with that artist and ensure that we're not operating in a public domain in a way that's going to do anything to add to the challenges that artists and their individual team members are experiencing. We will continue to do that, and we will see how this moves on. But the artist is a quality artist. The project team behind her is of quality too, and they will, I'm sure, have ambitions and ideas that they will want to go on to pursue. And as and when, we will continue to engage with them appropriately to understand how we may or may not have an ability to support that ambition.
I think that concludes questions from the committee. Can I thank both Mr. Munro and Mr. Wilson for your attendance at committee this morning? And we now move into private session.